is induction, charge by induction. The other one is charge by conduction. What is the basic difference here? Suppose, as I have shown it to you, this is this Goldilf electroscopes, this one. If I keep one positively charged rod here, and you see that there is some space between these two, still the divergence will be seen here. Why? Because the electrons that are attracted, they will come towards this one because it is influencing it. It is influencing the negative charge that is residing there on the foils. So these electrons will come up. Okay, remember, the electrons will only move. No protons will move. Protons are bounded within the nucleus. So electrons only will move. The charge transaction is always done through the electrons only, not by protons or any other particles. Okay, now these electrons will come nearer to this one because of the under the influence of this one, and they acquire positive. So that's the reason why they get the divergence. So what does it indicate? Suppose if you keep the positive charge here, this will become negative charge. That means you are inducing the opposite charge. So this is one way. This is called charging by induction. Now the other one, what is charging by conduction? So in that, we touch the positive, then it also gets the positive charge. Okay, so when we put it in contact, the same charge is transferred. When we keep the glass rod, or which is positively charged rod, far off, then you will get the opposite charge. In induction, you will induce the opposite charge. In conduction, by touching it, you will transfer the same nature of charge. So these are the two methods. So suppose a sphere is there. It is placed on an insulating stand, and I wanted to make this sphere as positive. Let's take that this is the sphere, and if it is placed on the insulating stand, and I wanted to make this sphere as positive. So what kind of thing you will do? So for positive, should I select a negatively charged object, or should I select a positively charged object? Suppose if I am keeping positive charge, what happens to this? And then if I am keeping negative charge, what sort of mechanism will be here? And then how can I make this entirely positive charge or entirely negative charge? So you try to solve this question. I'm keeping this straw. Now you can see the foil is diverged. Are you able to see that? When I remove, it is coming closer. When I keeping it on the disc, then it is, its divergence is increased. So this is our first observation. Yes, the charges are adding up. Why? Because initially when I placed it earlier, then you have seen in some divergence. When I kept the second straw, then you have seen the divergence is increased. Therefore, we can conclude that if you place the charges, they will be adding up. Now you see this divergence is there. If I keep my hand, what happens? Let's see. Can anyone give the answer for it? Why it has come down? Sharing of charges or passing of the charges through a conductor to the earth is called grounding or earthing. All of you must have seen what is the process of grounding. They will take one square plate, metallic plate, and then they will connect it to a wire, and then that wire will be connected to some electrical devices so that if any excess charge comes on the device, it will be directly leaked to the ground. Okay, that is called earthing or grounding. Now let me show you the other activity. Now again I have rubbed it and then I placed. Yesterday we talked, when we rub the plastic rod with silk cloth, if plastic rod gets positive charge, silk must be getting the opposite charge. Okay, now if really the silk gets opposite charge, if I place the silk cloth on the disc, what should have happened? Let's watch. Did you observe the thing? When I placed the silk, it's close or it is converged. Okay, so now it is diverged. Positive charge, let's consider. Now let me keep the silk on it. Then again, it has become neutral. So this is the second activity I wanted to show it to you. Now let us discuss the results and then let us write some properties based on these demonstrations. So the very first property is charges are additive. So what is the meaning of it? Suppose if in a vicinity, suppose plus 2e charge is there. Yesterday we talked about the e means electron charge, 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19 coulombs. Suppose if I take one electron charge, then the total charge will become 3 times the charge of the electron. Suppose if I take one electron charge and negative 2 electrons charge, then the total becomes minus 1 electron charge. It is just like an algebraic addition. So here this addition, suppose if you take 2e plus 1e, 3e, and 1e minus 2e, that is minus 1e. This is just we have proved with the activity. What we have proved actually, we have taken the gold leaf electroscope. We placed one straw. Suppose it consists of some N1 times of charge of the electron. And this is plus N1e. Okay, that's the first activity I have conducted for you. Now, second time, I have rubbed another straw and then I have placed that also on the same. Now let it be N2E. Now you have observed that the divergence is increased. Is it not? So here the total is, first it was like this, then second when I placed the second straw, the divergence is increased. Therefore, we can say this is for N1 plus N2 times of electron charge. Remember, it is sign sensitive. That also we have proved. How I proved this one? I took actually one straw, I placed it on the gold leaf, on the disc of the gold leaf electroscope, and then I kept nearer to it the silk cloth. So when I rubbed, let us suppose the charge gained by the that plastic rod is plus N1E. Yesterday I also told you that if any object having a tendency to lose the electrons, it gains positive charge. If any object is having a tendency to gain the electrons, it gets negative. But when we rub glass rod or plastic rod with silk cloth, suppose if glass rod is attaining 5 electron charge positive, then silk must attain minus 5 electron only, charge only. So this is N1E is the charge for the plastic rod. Then when I kept this silk cloth on it, N2E, but you have seen that it has touched the divergence become zero. So therefore, in that way, it becomes zero. So charge is additive, was proved through these activities. So hereafter, suppose in any vicinity or in any plane, suppose if you give 2 electrons charge first and then minus 3 electron charge next, the final answer will be minus 1 electron charge. Otherwise, suppose if minus 3 electrons charge is already there, and if you are giving suppose plus 5e charge, then the net will be plus 2e. So this tells us that charges are additive. Okay, so qualitatively we have demonstrated this. The other one, the next property is charge is conserved. So what we have defined, many law of conservation of many physical quantities like momentum, energy, we have defined. What is, yes, net charge is always zero. Suppose if you take one, what is the, we can easily prove it. Suppose if I take one silk cloth and this one is glass rod, okay. Then if I say glass rod is having 3 plus 3 electron charge, what does it indicate? It simply lost 3 electrons. These 3 electrons, where it has gone? It has gone onto the silk. So it is getting minus 3. So net charge is always 0. So that is only known as conservation of charge. So first we said charges are additive. Now we said charges, conservation of charges, that is the net charge is always zero. That is, if you take the isolated system, then the total charge is always remaining constant. The net charge of the system is always remaining constant. If you remember the definition or the statement of law of conservation of momentum, how did we define that? In an isolated system, the net momentum is always constant. So same is the case with the conservation of charge. Even when you would have conducted a lot of chemical reactions in your chemistry lab while doing the experiments, so there also the law of conservation of charge holds good. So suppose if sodium donates one electron, chlorine must take it. So you would have written the ionic bond equation as Na gives rise to Na plus plus one electron minus, because sodium is having 11 electrons in the total as total, and then in the outermost shell, one electron is there, so that chlorine is 17, so it wants to get one electron. So chlorine gets this electron and then it becomes Cl minus, and then finally NaCl is formed. The same is the case with the transaction of electrons anywhere. So this is the second property of charges. Now third one, quantization of charge. What do you understand by quantization? So quantization, actually this quantization, the idea of quantization of charge is given by Faraday. Through the experiment of electrolysis. Now let us state what is this quantization. Suppose if I rub the glass rod with the silk cloth, it is the charge acquired on the glass rod or the silk, only the nature is different. It is always in the integral multiples of the charge of electrons. So Q is either positive or negative of the charge of electrons. Q is equal to plus or minus Ne. As this N is number of electrons, so it should be an integer. So this is called quantization. Quantization means the charge available on any charged body is in integral multiples of the charge of the electron. So suppose if I rub the glass rod with the silk, I cannot attain 1.5 electrons charge or I cannot get 3.4 electrons charge. So these figures cannot be existing with the charge. So wherever the charge is available, the charge must be available with an integral multiple of charge of the electron. I may get plus 2 electron charge. I may get minus 100 electron charge. I may get minus 1024 electron charge, but I cannot get 1024.2 electron charge. I hope this concept is clear. Any doubt regarding quantization of this charge? Quantization is nothing but the charge available on any substance, or the charge always exists in the integral multiple of E, the charge of electron. The reason I told you, because total number of, how actually charge is transferred? Charge is transferred or either it is positive charge or negative charge. It is depending on the number of electrons that are moved from one object to another object. So Q is equal to either 5 electrons would have been transferred or 3 electrons would have been transferred. But it is not possible to transfer 2.1 electrons. So half of the portion of electron cannot be shifted to the other. So this is called quantization. So charges are additive, means if you place different charges, the net charge is simply addition of all the charges. Just I took the example, suppose if you place 5 electron charge and minus 10 electron charge, then the total would be minus 5e. Okay, now conservation of charge, that is the charge of an isolated system always remains constant. Suppose if I rub the glass rod with the silk, if glass rod attains some plus 3e charge, silk must attain minus 3e. There is no other go for it. glass can acquire plus 5e and silk will acquire only minus 2e. No, it's not possible. So that is called conservation of charge. The next point is quantization of charge. Quantization can be defined. The charge available on any substance is always in the integral multiples of electron charge only. Now, in chemistry, you would have studied that who has discovered the charge of the electron? Can anyone give the answer? Suppose if I know the charge of electron, if I divide by specific charge, then I can find m. Because you cannot measure the mass of the electron directly. It is Millikan. So Millikan oil drop method, he has taken several observations and then he has finally concluded that the charge on the electron is equal to negative times 1.6 in 10 to the power of minus 19 coulomb. But what method he has followed? A simple mathematical concept is involved in it. That what you have learnt in class 5th. Class 5th or maximum class 6th, you would have learnt that concept. He has used that concept to find the charge of the electron is this. And that is indirectly linked to the quantization of, directly linked to the quantization of charge. So we studied three properties of charges. One, charges are additive. Two, the charges are conserved. Three, the quantization of charge. So on the based on the quantization of charge, yesterday I asked one question and one of you have given the correct reply. Now let us do that. So I asked a question, how many electrons should be put together so that it gives one coulomb? So because coulomb is a very bigger charge, a bigger unit rather, bigger number. So here, if you take this equation, Q is equal to Ne. Here Q, that is one coulomb is given, and N you have to calculate, and then E, 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19. Now I wanted to get N. Therefore 1 by 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19. So if I remove this point, it becomes 20. So out of 20, I'll keep 18 here and I'll write 100 here because I have to divide it by 16. So if I take 16, 6 are 96, then 4.2, 16, 2s are 32, then 80, and then it is 5. So 6.25 into 10 to the power of 18 electrons are there in one coulomb charge. So to have one coulomb charge, you have to put 6.25 into 10 to the power of 18 electrons. So it is a very big unit. That's why we always measure charges in micro coulomb. That is 10 to the power of minus 6. Suppose if I write 5 micro coulomb, 5 into 10 to the power of minus 6 coulomb. Nanocoulombs, I took the gold leaf electroscope, I placed some charge and then these two foils got diverged, and when I touch this one, then immediately it comes back to zero. So that means through the person, here the person is acting like a conductor. So momentarily a small amount of current will pass through him, and then this entire charge will be grounded. Remember, the charge transaction is always done through the electrons only. Yesterday also I specified this problem. Now, the statement rather. Suppose if it is positive charge, what happens? The earth, from the earth, electrons will come through you and it nullifies it. Suppose if it is negative charge, then what happens? The electron will go through the conductor. So, the process of sharing the charges with the earth is called grounding. So, this is, now with the help of this, we will be able to charge the spheres of positive and negative. Let's see how can you do that. A sphere on the metal stand. And this is another sphere which is also metal sphere on the insulating stand. The stand is insulating one. And these are metals. Now you see, I took here one metal ball and then the insulating stand. This is another one. One I took steel, the other one is aluminium. I have to put them in contact first. Okay, now both are in contact. Now what I have to do, I have to keep either positive or negative charge rod here. Suppose if I keep positive charge here. Yesterday we talked about the induction and conduction. So in the process of induction, we will maintain a gap. So here what happens, it acquires the opposite charge. Then this acquires the same nature of charge of that rod. Okay. So now what we do, after acquiring this, we will simply separate it. See, we are charging. We can charge this one. So when I rub this one, so this will attain some charge, positive charge. Now I can keep this one here for some time. And under the influence of this only, I have to separate it. Now, what kind of charge would have been stored on the first one? Because I kept positive. What you said is correct. Electrons are attracted towards it. And then the empty spaces are where an electron goes out, then goes from that particular place, it acquires positive charge. So, this, now under the influence of it, I have separated them. Now what happens, this will be having negative, positive charge, and this will be having negative charge. Now, when we separate, the charge will adjust itself in such a way uniformly throughout this sphere. And here, negative charge will be there. This we can test whether it acquire negative, it acquire positive or not. How? With the help of this, again, this gold leaf electroscope only. So what I have to do, suppose if I keep this one first, then there will be divergence. So divergence will always be there, either you keep positive or negative. But when we keep the next one, what should happen? If it is of the same charge, the divergence should be increased. If it is of the opposite charge, the divergence will be decreased. Is that point clear? Now, when then that confirms that these two are charged spheres. So what is the process we have done here? Simply, we have made them in contact, two spheres on insulating stands. Suppose if it is not insulating, the charge will be leaked through that. Suppose if I take conductor, then through conductor, the charge will be leaked. So now, after that, I placed one positively charged particle, positively charged rod at some distance from the first sphere. Then the immediate sphere will, the electrons of that sphere will come towards this positive charge. They will be attracted. And then the opposite charge, that is negative, suppose negative is induced here, the positive will be induced here. And keeping the same under the influence of it only, we have to separate it. Later on, we can take out that positively charged rod. Then you will get the spheres, one positive, one negative. Now, if I want to make the first one positive, second one negative, then what should I do? That one is, the opposite one will be in the next one. So in that way, we can make the charged spheres. I hope that this is conductors and insulators. Later on, in the last lesson, we will come to know that there is another kind of substance, which is called semiconductors. Okay. Now, there are two types of substances. Now, here, it is very easy, of course. A simple circuit I have taken. I have connected a bulb. And I took one battery illuminator here. Then a universal clip I just connected. If I join these two, the circuit gets completed. I wanted to get this circuit completed first by a substance wire. So you are able to see the bulb is glown. Okay. So this electric wire, which is made up of copper, is a conductor. Now I keep, this is very simple activity, of course, but seeing is believing. So I connected this plastic straw in between. So here, no bulb is glown. So plastic is considered as insulator. So now I have connected this dish across the two. Now you have seen that the bulb was glown. Then you can say that this is a conductor. It is in fact made up of aluminium